Good afternoon. I'd like to call the East Chicago Board of Public Works meeting November 23rd, 2011 to order. Roll call.
Bel Gomez.
Present.
Jezreel Rodriguez.
Present.
Carla Morgan.
Present.
Next on agenda is the minutes from our last meeting on November 9th. Can I have a motion to accept the minutes as written?
So moved.
Second it.
Roll call.
Bel Gomez.
Yes.
Jezreel Rodriguez.
Yes.
Carla Morgan.
Yes.
Okay, under correspondence, we have a letter of interest for 4609 Todd Avenue. To East Chicago Board of Works from Miguel. How do you pronounce that?
He's here, actually.
Is the gentleman here?
Yes.
Could you please come to the front? Mm-hmm. How do you put your last name?
Okay. Chavez.
Chavez? Miguel, who's Miguel?
Miguel.
What's your name? How do you pronounce your last name?
Arriano.
Arriano? Okay. Okay, you're the business owner of Sunrise Auto Repair?
No, this is Miguel's Auto Repair.
Okay, and your letter states, letter of interest for the property across the street from my business located at 608 Exchange. The property in interest is at 4609 Todd. We are currently using the property as a customer vehicle parking lot during the day. Vehicles are waiting to be picked up. There was an issue with code enforcement concerning the parking in a private property. My intention with this property is to lease or purchase the property to have access for parking for my customer vehicles. If any arrangement, my plan is to make the property look nice, to have a fence all around, and blacktop to beautify the property instead of making it look like a plain parking lot. And enclosed is a description of the property. And the owner of the property is the City of East Chicago Board of Public Works. It's 4609 Todd. So I imagine, what's the next step?
Actually, the gentleman came in and met with me, along with the owner of Sunrise Auto, and explained their dilemma that they have an auto repair business there at the corner of Todd and Exchange, and business is doing pretty good and don't have enough room right now to be able to maneuver during the day and service all the cars that they get in there. They had been informally using the corner of that big lot at Todd, which is owned by the Board of Works, but it's also subject to a pretty wide railroad easement. And so their request, which obviously they put here in writing, is that they have the use of at least the corner of that property so that they can continue to do business in that location. And they're now closed in. They had previously, in years past, made a proposal to expand, which unfortunately wasn't approved, but this is to allow them again to continue to grow. So my recommendation is that we immediately refer this to the planning department, our city planner, Dwayne Williams, so he can make recommendations about subdividing that lot, because it is a pretty big lot, like we said, and you only want a corner of it anyway.
Yeah, the corner.
And again, his name is Dwayne Williams. He's a city planner. We'll make sure you have his number, but we'll also refer these documents to him and have him contact you.
Okay.
And I'll make sure that happens by Monday, that he has everything and you can talk to him. And then my recommendation to city attorney is that we would lease the lot to you.
Okay.
So with that, we'll, you know, figure out what the value is and what the terms would be. And then you already talked about blacktopping the lot, so we'll reach an agreement on that. So. You know, we don't want to have any undue delays, so like I said, we'll get the paperwork over to him right away, and then you should work with him. Now, ultimately, you'll have to come, whatever the city arrives at with you, whatever agreement, would have to be approved by this board, and then you can move forward, so.
Okay.
Okay, so,
So this is, you know, this is speaking for our business, you know, for Miguel's, you know, that corner. But in that map, you know, this, the other person is also interested, which is Sunrise.
Yeah, in a different.
So pretty much looking towards the same, right, with Dwayne?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, he should work with the
department.
Yeah, you're going to have to work with, for both properties. So there's two owners, one, they want to get two sections of it.
Yeah, and the reason why it's kind of an irregular shape is because of the easement that goes across.
Yeah, yeah.
The reason why it's curved on one end. But again, you know, this is what Dwayne does. He can figure it out and recommend how it should be subdivided.
Okay, now according to the lease, who do I speak to with that?
Start with Dwayne, but the city law office will work at finalizing it, which means you would come back and see me in my capacity in that office, and we'll work it out.
Okay, so we'll just want to contact Dwayne, or you'll let him know?
I'll contact Dwayne and give him the documents, and then if you would contact him on Monday, if you just call the city's general number, 391-8200, or I think his office is
the car firm directly with Dwayne.
You want his card?
No, I got it.
Okay. All right. Well, then just call him Monday, and he should have everything because I'll send it to him.
Okay, sounds good.
Okay.
All right, thanks.
All right, thank you.
Thank you. Okay, next under correspondence, we have a correspondence from BP pertaining to the heavy haul route agreement. Do we have someone from BP to speak on that?
Mr. President, thanks, members of the Board of Works. Essentially,
would you state your name?
My name is Tom Kyleman. I'm Director of Government Public Affairs for BP. Basically, back in November of 2008, the refinery, when we were beginning to undertake our modernization project, established a heavy haul route agreement with the city, and it was approved by the Board of Works back in November of 2008. And before you have a packet with a map that shows you the heavy haul route. There's a copy of the agreement along with a heavy haul permit that was granted to us by the East Chicago Police Department. Subsequent to the establishment of the agreement, we had the circumstance where the Indiana Department of Transportation closed the Klein Avenue Bridge and subsequently took over a portion of Dickey Road, including the Dickey Bridge, that my understanding is now part of the state highway system. A portion of the NDOT's highway system is part of this heavy haul route that extends from the west side of the Dickey Bridge to the intersection of Riley Road. So tonight what we're asking, we've been in communication with NDOT. Part of the request from the East Chicago Police Department is to get an NDOT permit for that portion of the road from the bridge to Riley Road, which is approximately about 900 feet. We've been in communication with NDOT to secure that permit. We're in the process of supplying them with some data, and we'll have that to them shortly after the holiday. Because of the timing of the agreement and the permit we're requesting tonight, that the Board of Works grant us a 30-day extension of the existing agreement until we can get the data supplied to the Indiana Department of Transportation and can secure an Indiana Department of Transportation heavy haul permit from the state. After that is completed, then we will come back to you in December with proof of the agreement from NDOT, and we'll request an extension for the heavy haul route agreement until we complete the project sometime in the middle of 2013. So basically tonight we're just asking for an extension for 30 days until we can work out the agreement with NDOT and come back with you proof of that agreement with the Indiana Department of Transportation.
Okay. Do you have any questions? Do you have no objection?
No.
Okay. This motion, can I have a motion to extend for a 30-day extension of the current heavy haul route agreement with BP, which we have currently in place?
So move.
Second.
Roll call.
Del Gomez?
Yes.
Jethro Rodriguez?
Yes.
Carla Morgan?
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you, Mr. President. You all have a very nice, happy Thanksgiving.
Thank you.
Okay. There's no further correspondence. We'll move on to new business. First on agenda is opening proposals for 38, 34, 36 Butternut, and from the building department.
Good evening. Wina Guzman, interim building commissioner.
Mm-hmm.
On October 26, 2011, the Board of Public Works received and publicly opened sealed proposals regarding emergency demolition for this property, which is 38, 34 through 36 Butternut. On November 9, 2011, I came before this board on this matter and recommended obtaining new proposals to exclude demolition and removal of any subsurface structures, such as foundations, basement walls, basement flooring and footings, in order to bring the demolition cost down. Again, the demolition will only include removal of the immediate danger, which is the above ground structure. I submitted a total of 4 sealed envelopes containing proposals and 1 fax proposal received on today's date to Ms. Olga Cosme to present to this board today. I ask that this board open the sealed envelopes and read the fax proposal before this public meeting. And upon my receipt of the proposals from Ms. Cosme, I will review set proposals and make my recommendation, hopefully by the end of today's meeting. Again, the owners of record will be assessed any and all costs incurred by the city for demolition services, including possible civil penalties being assessed.
Okay, so this was discussed at the last meeting?
Yes.
Yes.
Just for record, I wasn't here at the last meeting, so. Okay, we'll proceed with opening the 4, and we have 1 that was faxed, right?
Yes.
Okay. The first one is from Acton Inc. at 1102 East Columbus Drive, East Chicago, Indiana. And their bid is for $62,950. Proposal number T11160-63-02. Next one is from Beckstein Construction Company, and they're total for above scope of work is $49,250. We have the fax bid from Boyd Construction Company, Incorporated. Their bid is for $62,500.
Need some help.
Well, they glued it too good here. Next one's from National Wrecking Company, and their quote is for We have to talk to people about putting tape all over these envelopes. Last one is from JM Industrial Services Incorporated. Their bid is for total amount $48,800. So you're going to review these, and then hopefully by the end of the meeting you'll be able to...
Yes, I can review them right out here.
Tell us if everything's proper with them?
Yes.
Okay. We're going to give it to her right now, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
I could have done that. Okay. I thought I was doing it.
Okay. Thank you. Coming up before the board, so it's okay. I'll stay here.
And you're, which other property?
The Drummond Street.
Oh, I see. Okay. So you have a notice of emergency order to demolish part of 3917 Drummond?
Yes. This is a multi-unit property. This is an abandoned vacant property and was a scene of a fire back in 2009, which caused extensive fire damage to the structure. The owner of record is Laura White, and she is deceased. I have photos to share with you. This property is being brought before this board to notify this board that a notice of emergency order to demolish part of an unsafe building was issued, as the property had been found to be unsafe, posing an imminent danger to the life, health, and safety of persons occupying or using nearby property. As a result, and pursuant to IC 36799A, I had issued an order to an independent contractor to remove the imminent danger, which entailed partial demolition and removal of north and south side brick walls, removing any and all loose bricks. The imminent danger has been abated and the property has been stabilized. I will seek condemnation demolition proceedings on this property in the near future. And
what time frame would you like the building taken down? Are you trying to see if the owners will, or the people inherited, can take it down? And then, if not,
yes,
the city
I'm going to bring them before the Board of Safety. I'm looking probably within the next month. Mm-hmm. We will request that they appear before the Board of Public Safety on condemnation demolition proceedings, and then we'll move forward from there.
Okay.
If they fail to... if the order to demolish is entered by the Board of Safety, and if the heirs fail to adhere to the order, then the property will be placed on the demolition list. This order will be recorded with the county, and I will also pursue collection of the demolition costs incurred by the city.
Okay. You just like for us to be aware and take this under advisement, but not take action right now?
No, there's no action. No, there's no action. Just to advise that the proposals were immediately requested from three East Chicago contractors, and the work was awarded to the contractor who submitted the lowest proposal, which was Solis Construction.
Okay.
Because of the imminent danger, we had to act upon it.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a weekend, a long weekend. It was on the 11th, so we had to act quickly. As soon as they touched the bricks, the brick wall just collapsed further.
Okay.
The pictures do show that. Also, I would commend the building commissioner. She was out there on her day off overseeing that project. So
thank you.
Shows you're dedicated. And
thank you.
We appreciate that.
Thank you.
Okay.
And that concludes my report on this.
Okay. Any questions? No. Okay.
And
thank
if
you.
I could get at the end of the meeting the photos back. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Next on our agenda is a cost analysis for outsourcing MacArthur Golf Course. If we have anyone here to speak on that.
Good afternoon, Fernando Trevino with FMT Consulting. You should have in your packet a cost analysis report dated November 22nd, 2011 that basically analyzes three scenarios. One is outsourcing, and the other is whether if the city were to manage MacArthur Golf Course directly. The report was generated from information from the city's park department, city controller's office, and the city's HR human resources office to obtain information that was put in the report. Just to summarize, the outsourcing cost is estimated at approximately $127,000. The scenario number two on hiring two full-time employees is estimated at $149,000. And scenario number three, hiring two seasonal employees, is $103,000. And however, that would have a limited season because per the HR office, the limit on the amount that the seasonal workers could work is 26 weeks before they become full-time employees. So that would cut out about 4 months of use for MacArthur Golf Course. I also added in the report other cost data for your consideration, and included park revenues that I received from the city and an estimated cost for the concession stand workers. One of the attachments is a summary table that breaks it out between management, labor, and the chemicals, seed, and maintenance, of equipment. I also included as an attachment a survey that was done on the quality of park December 8, 2009, that speaks on behalf of our current maintenance manager ServiceScape. And if you take a look at the survey, it showed high marks for the park. This concludes this report. If there are any questions, I'd be happy to answer them.
This includes managing everything at MacArthur, so the miniature golf, the batting cages, and the whole entire...
That's correct. In order to... kind of compare apples with apples, the assumptions that were used for the management and maintenance of the park included 43 weeks, two workers working 40 hours per week for 10 months, March through December, and an additional 8 hours on weekends, 4 hours Saturday, 4 hours Sunday, when the golf course was open, and that was 31 weeks. And yes, this does include the maintenance of the grounds for the golf course and the putt-putt and around the batting cages. It doesn't include maintenance of the equipment of the batting cages, which is done by the city. And, you know, again, the information obtained was through meetings and interviews with the Park Department, City Controller's Office, and the Human Resources. And just to kind of reacquaint the board, the idea was to evaluate the costs for managing it internally versus outsourcing it to see if there were any opportunities to change the management style of the park, so the city can decide which way to go in 2012. So if there's any questions, I'd be happy to answer them.
I know, Senator, revenue, we made $30,554, and that included everything in the batting cages and miniature golf. And
yes, that's the number that was provided to me by the controller's office, and it was my understanding that the numbers were reported as a lump sum, so it wasn't segregated from all those items that you mentioned.
So basically, with these figures right here, the golf course doesn't pay for itself. We would have to supplement it.
That's correct. Well, and probably the city has probably 15 or more parks, and this is probably one or of the top five that produces any revenue. So, and you know, it's something for the city to decide if they like to have that recreational outlet for the community and kids, and balancing it with all the other budget items and decisions the city needs to make. But you know, this kind of helps outline what the cost would be if the city decided to handle it internally. And the other thing I wanted to add on this is that based on conversation from the Park Department, they don't have the current manpower resources to handle the park. They would have to hire two people to handle it. And that's why the added cost.
Yeah, either way there'd be cost involved. Either way, we're gonna have to do something. Okay, thank you. We'll take it under advisement. And
okay, and if the board needs any additional information or any other questions to help in its decision making, just let me know. Thanks. Happy Thanksgiving, everyone.
Thank you.
Okay. Next on the agenda is the Winston Terrell Group Agreement. I think our city attorney would.
The Winston Terrell Group, they advise a number of other municipalities on things like federal grants that are available and help guide cities and other governmental entities through the process of applying for federal monies for certain types of grants. So what this contract allows is for them to do work for the city on an as-needed basis, and only they only be paid for things that we agree to pay them to work on for the city. And again, it's not to replace our current grant writer or grant writing activities. It's a supplement, because they do have a good knowledge of federal grants and other things that we can reach out and might not otherwise be aware of. So we won't have overlap between our current grant writing efforts. This will be for new things and new monies that would come in. We did insist that certain things be put into the contract, like the number not to exceed. So for work that the city actually agreed to have them do, they'd be paid $150 an hour for a total of up to 20 hours per month. Even if their work exceeds 20 hours per month, the most they can be paid in a given month is $3,000, and the most that they can earn under this contract is $36,000 a year. And also, the contract would be from the date that is executed through December 31st, 2012. So it's basically just about 13 months, and it will terminate unless we extend it. So that's kind of it. They've agreed to confidentiality with the city and, you know, to follow ethical guidelines, including compliance with the state's E-Verify program. So that's kind of it in a nutshell. But again, this is to bring monies to the city that the city has not been aware of, and mm-hmm. to kind of supplement our budget and help us to do the infrastructure projects that we know we have to do.
Right.
I have a question. Who's going to overseeing these company? Will be a law department. Will be so who's gonna?
Well, the mayor's office is who actually would give them the orders to proceed okay. or not proceed on a given project. And then if a grant say impacts things would involve city planning, they work with the city planner. If there's things with the mm-hmm. controller's office, or they work with various departments, but it'd be the mayor's office ordering them to do whatever it is that they are going to be doing.
And they also, one other thing, when we did have a meeting with them a few months ago, they also would work with our grant writer. They said they would exchange information with her, you know, so they would work hand in hand together.
And this is a company that has a good statewide reputation. Mm-hmm. So again, they do things for cities all over Indiana, and I think outside of Indiana too, but primarily here. And we've heard great things about them. They seem very capable.
Okay. Any further questions?
No.
Entertain a motion to accept the consulting service agreement with Winston Terrell Group. A motion?
So moved.
Second it.
Roll call.
Bel Gomez?
Yes.
Jezreel Rodriguez?
Yes.
Carla Morgan?
Yes.
Next on agenda is a Don M. Dawkins legal service contract, and I think our city attorney can speak on this also.
Okay. This contract, again, is for legal services. She's a local attorney who maintains an office here in town. She would handle certain things like code violations and assist code enforcement quite a bit with things that we're going to step up. We have stepped up our enforcement, but we'll step up the court call and what we do in East Chicago City Court. And for that, she has agreed to be paid $125 an hour, which is kind of the standard going rate for local attorneys. She'll bill in 1/10 hour increments. And overall, for the year, her amount not to exceed is $20,000. Now, the city law office will oversee it, and, you know, hope we don't approach that number. But again, no matter what, we can't exceed it. But also, there are times when I have filled in for city court. So, you know, where we can minimize costs, we'll keep on doing that. But again, it's very important in our overall efforts to improve the city that we have teeth in our code enforcement, and the only way you can do that is to take these things to city court and have the judge rule on things when people just refuse to comply with orders. So that is the underlying reason for the contract. But other than that, again, it's for a year. It would terminate December 31st, 2012. She'd invoice us on a regular basis, and it has, you know, the term and the amount not to exceed that we require now. So are there any questions on it?
So basically, it's the work with our code enforcement then?
Yeah.
Okay.
There was a cover letter with it where she talks about she does have a completely unrelated case pending against the city, but she has to reveal that she has, it's not really a conflict of interest, because as I said, it's not related to code enforcement at all, but she did reveal that in a letter to the law office, which... I don't have it here, but I'll share it with mm-hmm. the board. But we reviewed it, and there's no problem.
And her rate of service will be for $125 an hour?
Yeah.
Are there any other questions on this?
No.
Entertain a motion to accept the legal contract between the city and Don M. Dawkins.
So move.
Second.
Roll call.
Val Gomez.
Yes.
Jezreel Rodriguez.
Yes.
Carla Morgan.
Yes.
Okay, next on agenda is a supplemental number 2, Railroad Avenue Grade Separation Project. Do we have anybody to speak on that, or?
I'm gonna speak on that. This is a supplemental number 2 to the original construction engineering agreement between the City of Chicago and RQAW for additional 12 days for inspection service to finish the completion of the project. The main reason of these additional 12 days was a water main break that we had late September, I think it was September 22nd, 23rd. So, and we had to extend the completion day. So at the same time, we had to extend the construction inspection service for the consultants. So they're asking for 12 additional days. They deserve to get paid. They work hard. Those, especially those days, to try to open the bridge. So, if you have any other question? I'd be happy to answer the question.
This is the issue they had already previously made us aware of, as far as the construction manager had. Correct.
Excuse me.
We were already made aware of the 12-day delay. I recall them talking about it.
Well, there's one supplemental was for an extension of time for a strike, and basically that was for a strike and some change order. And the original section, the revised completion day was October 19th. With the water main breaks, we never asked for additional time, and basically this change order or supplemental reflect that extension of time to finish the project. So basically we're 12 days that the contractor needed to finalize the construction. At the same time, the construction inspection in those days. So this is the result of the unforeseen field conditions, basically.
Okay.
So they're asking us to approve the additional amount of $21,552?
Yes. If you look the package at the, there is an attachment with the rates, hourly rates and hours and the cost per day and mileage cost per day, and basically the $21,000, that's $552. So you can see the breakdown of the $21,552.
Okay. Any other questions?
No.
Entertain a motion to accept the supplemental request of $21,552 for project 210-00055.1 Railroad Avenue.
So moved.
Second.
Roll call.
Val Gomez.
Yes.
Jezreel Rodriguez.
Yes.
Carla Morgan.
Yes.
Okay. Next on agenda, we have the AT&T ISDM Prime Service Agreements. Does someone speak on it?
Good evening. Kevin Klosak, System Administrator for the city. What you have before you are three separate agreements. They're actually renewal agreements for the individual T1 or prime circuits servicing the telco systems at the locations of 4440 Railroad Avenue, which is a city annex building, 4525 Indianapolis Boulevard, City Hall, and the third one is 400 East Chicago Avenue, which is the water department. These renewals are based on the state of Indiana QPA pricing that we receive from AT&T. They are three-year, the pricing is for a three-year agreement. The expiration of the current agreement is, they're each sometime within the first week of December. So it's my recommendation to renew these agreements for the QP pricing. I believe they are, $490 a piece. If we do go out of maintenance or service period, they revert back to the standard AT&T pricing, which is about $2,900 per circuit. So it's, once again, my recommendation that the board approve these renewals.
Any questions? No?
You know, what is the current rate that we pay? Is it?
I believe, currently it's, $465. So it's like an increase of like $20 or so from what the current rate is.
And just so members of the public know, what do we run off of these lines?
Basically, these are individual, they're trunks of 24 circuits, and a circuit is just basically an open telco communication line, and within each location, you have the LAN phone numbers, faxes, and so forth. So I believe in City Hall, we have approximately 30 numbers, of which we pay 20 cents a piece. Those all basically, all incoming and outgoing phone traffic travels through these 24 circuits. Circuits are open, call goes in or call goes out. So they are not dedicated per phone line per se, but it's just 24 available circuits per location for all incoming and outgoing telco traffic.
Any other questions?
No.
Okay, I'll entertain a motion to accept the AT&T ISDM Prime Service Agreements at these three locations, 4440 Railroad Avenue, 400 East Chicago Avenue, 4525 Indianapolis Boulevard.
So moved.
Second it.
Roll call.
Val Gomez.
Yes.
Jezreel Rodriguez.
Yes.
Carla Morgan.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. Next on agenda, right-of-way applications from engineering department.
Yes. I would like to have a vote on the first one, especially, and then I will read the rest of the application. The first application, it's permit application number 11-01A50, permit type Ipsit Byway. Address is 4933 Olcott Avenue, Chicago. Description, installed driveway alongside of resident, which will lead onto Olcott Avenue. My personal, I will not recommend this driveway because there is an existing garage with two garage doors. So that's my opinion, so I would like to vote on this one and then move forward with the rest of the other one. So you have any question on this?
You're recommending that we do approve this?
No, I won't recommend.
You won't?
Yes.
Oh.
No. It was presented by supervisor of the engineering department. When I drove around this morning, and I normally don't allow driveways on houses that have garages. And they have access, so I have to justify a driveway. Otherwise, I think we have to allow all the people that request a driveway. So, and we are going to lose a lot of parking spaces in front of our public right-of-way. But that's my opinion. So, I think we should go for votes. And if you are okay with that, it's fine. This application need two votes. So
this driveway doesn't go to the garage. It's separate? It's a separate?
It's an additional driveway to the house.
Mm-hmm. So you would entertain a motion not to accept this?
Yeah, but I would like to go for both, and but it's my opinion, so.
Okay, we have a work permit application number 11-0185. The vote is whether to install it, yes or no. Install a driveway along the sides of the residence. Can we entertain a motion to vote on whether to accept this or not?
I move that we bring this to a yes or no vote on whether to approve this driveway application. It's permit application number 11-01850.
So we make a motion? We have to make a motion?
That was my motion.
That's your motion?
Yeah, I move that we bring it to a yes or no vote.
We have the second?
Yeah.
You second?
Second.
Okay, roll call.
Val Gomez?
No.
Jezreel Rodriguez?
No.
Carla Morgan?
No.
Okay, moving forward with the rest of the application, the next application, it's 11-01851, permit type dumpster, address 3833 First Street in Chicago. Description, locate dumpster in front of resident at the curb. Next application number 11-01852, permit type driveway, address 2131 Maximum Drive, location 400 West Columbus Drive, description, cup curb and installed driveway approach upfront for Explorer Pipeline for construction project. Next application, 11-01853, permit type utility. Location, 143rd Road, Parish Avenue. Description, street drain repair in need of blacktop resurfacing. Next one, 11-01854, permit type right away. Location, on the 29th Street, Indianapolis Boulevard. Description, installing storm sewer on 129th Street from IHBRR office to Dickey Road Stormwater. Next application number 11-01855, permit type utility. Location on the 49th Street, Homerly Avenue. Description, main sewer break at intersection repair in need of blacktop resurfacing. Permit application number 11-01856. Permit type utility. Location 519 West on the 42nd Street. Description, sinkhole at location repair in need of resurfacing. Permit application number 11-01857. Permit type right away. Location 500 Riley Road. Description, soil borings. Test holes along Riley Road, core samples. Next one, 11-01858, permit type right away. Location 5622nd Reading Avenue. Description, installing 7 soil vapor monitoring wells for remediation purposes associated with 1402 Carroll Street site. And that's it. Is there any question regarding the rest of the application?
That final one where it has, where you're installing vapor monitoring wells, what was at that location before?
The last What's one? The number of the?
It's the last one.
58?
Where they're putting the vapor monitoring wells?
Yeah, this is regarding the project on the Indianapolis Boulevard.
Oh, is that with
they're working
with the dredging?
Dredging.
Oh, yeah. The dredging project?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So I need a motion.
I move that we approve right-of-way permit application numbers 11-01851 through 11-01858.
Second it.
Roll call.
Val Gomez.
Yes.
Jezreel Rodriguez.
Yes.
Carla Morgan.
Yes.
Okay, that concludes our new business. Now we'll move on to old business. We have one item on agenda under old. It's 4135 Carey Street, grant of easement.
We did receive we did receive from the attorney for the seller the grant of easement, which has a legal description. They did the stake survey, which we have a copy in the law office. The city engineer has a copy that describes the easement to be granted. Okay. And can you approach and introduce yourself again on the... Okay.
Sorry. Good evening.
No, you're fine.
My name is Javier Chavez, real estate broker from Macaulay Real Estate. There was an offer or purchase agreement back in August of 24th of 2011. The property, it's actually 4136 Carey. That was a typo error on my part probably before, so it should be 4136 Carey. The offer was accepted, except that we found out that there was a 66-foot right-of-way in which the city owned, where the previous owners were using that property to access their garage and doing other things. Since then, we've acquired a stake survey, creating an appurtenant easement in which the city would be the serving tenement and then the sellers would be the dominant tenement. And therefore, now there's an easement that has been prepared legally, and we're asking the city for, it's approximately 19-foot by 100-foot easement that we're using so that there could be appropriate access to the 4136 property. And therefore, we did have a stake survey done, which you have a copy, which I do have extra copies if y'all don't have one here. Do you need another one?
We don't have to have
okay.
another one.
Okay. And there's also been a legal document prepared by a real estate attorney. It's all under the umbrella. If approved by the board, then we would go ahead and present it to the title company, in which case they would get it recorded in the county. Therefore, they would ensure the easement right away so that the loan can be processed and closed. And we're looking and closing the week after next, if allowed.
And we had discussed the issue before, which is this house sits at 142nd and Carey Street.
That's correct.
On the north side of that little intersection.
That's correct.
The driveway from the garage exits over the city's right-of-way.
Correct.
So you have to cross over the city sidewalk and that little area. The current owner has maintained that strip of land, including the grass, for decades now.
Correct.
And they're trying to sell that property. And in order to sell it, the title company won't guarantee it unless they know that the new owner will be able to exit the driveway.
That the city would grant the easement, correct.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right. And again, we had discussed that we know that this is an issue for other properties along 142nd, 143rd, and other properties in that area.
Mm-hmm.
So, and with that, I did review the document. Things seem to be in order, as well as with the survey that was done. So if there are questions, I may be able to answer from a legal standpoint or maybe you from a real estate standpoint, but I would recommend that the board do approve the easement. One thing, though, is we've got to get it notarized, so we may not be able to execute it tonight. It may be Monday to have it actually notarized. So, are there any... Okay.
And we do have the sellers here present.
Okay. Well, if you stick around after the meeting, we may
sure.
be able to do it tonight.
All right.
Okay.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
No further questions?
Any questions?
No.
And there is the fee of $10, the consideration for the easement. So, which is fine. We just ask you to write a check to the city controller's office and reference this property.
Whichever way you decide, no problem.
Okay.
Okay, thank you.
There be no questions, entertain a motion to grant an easement for 4135 Carey Street.
So move.
Second.
Roll call.
Val Gomez.
Yes.
Jezreel Rodriguez.
Yes.
Carla Morgan.
Yes.
Okay. Is there any other business? That's right, I forgot. Have you had time to review the...
Yes, I have. And I have reviewed all the proposals submitted and recommend awarding the demolition work to JM Industrial in the amount of $48,800 for the demolition of 3834 through 36 Butternut.
JM Construction?
I return these to the secretary and then she can make copies and then return the originals to me.
Okay.
When she's done, okay.
Can we have so I could...
Okay.
Okay, so based on our recommendation from our building commissioner, entertain a motion to accept the bid from JM Industrial Services Incorporated of 201 Marble Street, Hammond, for an amount of $48,800. Can I have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Roll call.
Val Gomez.
Yes.
Jezreel Rodriguez.
Yes.
Carla Morgan.
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay. Is there any other business? No? There being no other business, our next regular meeting will be Wednesday, December 14th, 2011 at 4:30 p.m. Can I have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
Roll call.
Val Gomez.
Yes.
Jezreel Rodriguez.
Yes.
Carla Morgan.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
The dead,